Hello, I'm Akinori Hoseyamada from NTT Secure Platform Laboratories. This is a work on quantum cryptanalysis on contracting Feistel structures and some observations on related to these settings. This is a joint work with Carlos Schitt, Yunwen Liu, and Xiamen Shim. First, I will explain about an overview of our research. As you might know, by using Grover's quantum algorithm, we can obtain some speed up on the generic attacks on symmetric key crypto systems. For example, the exhaustive key search on n-bit keys can be sped up from 2 to the power n in the classical setting to 2 to the power n over 2 in the quantum setting. Similarly, collision attacks can be sped up from 2 to the power n over 2 in the classical setting to 2 to the power n over 3 in the quantum setting. So, we can obtain some quantum speed up to some extent by using Grover search. However, the speed up by Grover search is always at most quadratic. So, it had been considered that the impact of quantum computers on symmetric key cryptanalysis would be not so significant. However, recently, it is shown that exponential speed up is possible not only for public key crypto systems, but also for symmetric key crypto systems. For example, the even Mansur cipher is proven to be secure to 2 to the power n over 2 queries in the classical setting, but it can be broken in polynomial time in the quantum setting. And similarly, the three-round Feistel structure is proven to be secure in the classical setting, up to 2 to the power n over 2 chosen plaintext queries. However, in the quantum setting, there exists a CPA chosen plaintext attack distinguisher that runs in polynomial time in the quantum setting. And so, exponential speedup is also possible for symmetric key crypto systems. And this speedup is obtained by using Simon's quantum algorithm. And actually, these polynomial time attacks are done in a specific quantum attack model called Q2 model. So, next, I will explain about quantum attack models. So, this picture illustrates the usual classical chosen plaintext attack. There is an adversary who has a computer, and there is an encryption oracle. And in the quantum setting, we can consider the situation that the computer of the adversary is replaced with the quantum computer. This model is called Q1 model. And in the quantum setting, we can also consider another attack model called Q2 model. Here, now the encryption oracle and the communication channels are both replaced with quantum ones. And so, now the adversary can make queries in quantum superpositions, and the responses from oracles are also in quantum superpositions. All the previous attacks that run in polynomial time are done in this Q2 model, and we also use this attack model, Q2 model. Next, I will explain about Feistel structures. So, this picture illustrates the three-round Feistel structures, which converts 3 n-bit PRFs F1, F2, F3 into a 2 n-bit permutation. Given a 2 n-bit input, it divides the input into two parts, the left branch and the right branch. And the left branch will be the input of the first round function, and the output is added with the right branch. And then the left branch and the right branch will be swapped. And similarly, the second round transformation and the third round transformation will be performed similarly. This picture illustrates the three-round version, but we can also define a four-round Feistel structure and a five-round Feistel structure, and so on. And so now the question is this permutation becomes a secure PRP if F1, F2, F3 are secure PRFs? In the classical setting, the answer is yes, because it is proven to be secure against polynomial time CPAs. However, in the quantum setting, the answer is no, because Kuwakado and Mori showed that by using Simon's algorithm, it can be distinguished from an ideal permutation, ideally random permutation in polynomial time. In the previous slide, I explained about Feistel structures. And actually, there are many generalized versions of Feistel structures. And on some versions that were secure in the classical setting, there exist polynomial time quantum attacks, as well as the three-round Feistel structures. For example, the D branch 3D-3-round type 1 generalized Feistel structure is secure against polynomial time attacks in the classical setting. However, there exists a polynomial time quantum attack that breaks this scheme. And similarly, there also exist non-trivial polynomial time quantum attack on type 2 generalized Feistel structures. However, there has been few works about quantum attacks on a generalized version called contracting Feistel structures. Recall that the single round transformation of Feistel structure looks like this. It has two branches. And a single round transformation of contracting Feistel structure looks like this. So now it has many branches. And this picture illustrates the case of four branches. And first, the sum is taken over all branches except for the rightmost branch, like this here. And this sum becomes the input to the round function. And the output of the round function is added with the rightmost branch. And then, the branches are rotated like this. As I mentioned before, there has been few works about quantum attacks on contracting Feistel structures. Please note that in this talk, all the attacks are chosen plaintext attacks, both in classical and quantum settings. In the classical setting, there is a previous work that claims that D branch 2D minus 1 round contracting Feistel is secure in the classical setting. And here, there is a condition that D must be even. Because if D is odd, then the contracting Feistel structure can never be pseudorandom. And so now, the natural question is, can we break D branch 2D minus 1 round contracting Feistel structure in polynomial time chosen plaintext attacks? This is the starting point of our research. And in our paper, we showed these three results. First, we showed that there exists a polynomial time quantum chosen plaintext attack distinguisher on D branch 2D minus 1 round contracting Feistel structures. Second, we showed that when each round function has the form like this, that is, the input x is first added with the secret round key ki, and then processed with a public function fi. Then we can also recover the keys of d branch 2d minus 1 round contracting Feistel structure in polynomial time. That is, when each round function has this form, then we can mount not only distinguishing attack, but also key recovery attacks. When the round function has this form, then we refer to the Feistel structure as the Feistel KF structure because the input is first added with the key K and then processed with the function F. And finally, we also showed some quantum related key attacks on Feistel KF structure and contracting Feistel KF structure. That is, when related key oracles are available, non-trivial QCPAs, quantum chosen plaintext attacks, are possible on more rounds. So we showed these three results in our paper. And all the attacks are based on Simon's quantum period finding algorithm. And actually, these attacks can be extended to exponential time key recovery attacks on more rounds by using Grover's algorithm. But here, in this talk, I don't have enough time to explain details. So please check our paper for details. Very recently, we noticed that there is a concurrent work by Hozick and Knudsen, and the title of the paper is A Quantum Distinguisher for 7 and 8 Round SMS4 Block Cipher, which is recently published on a journal. Here, SMS4 or SM4 is a Chinese national standard block cipher with four branch contracting Feistel KF structure. And in their paper, they showed polynomial time distinguisher on 7-round contracting Feistel. On the other hand, we show not only distinguisher, but also polynomial time key recovery attacks on Feistel KF and various related key attacks, while they do not. Next, I will explain about Simon's algorithm and Kuwakado and Mori's distinguisher on 3-round Feistel, because our attack on contracting Feistel is based on Kuwakado and Mori's distinguisher, and their distinguisher uses Simon's algorithm. Please consider this problem. Suppose that there is a function f and a bit string s such that for all x, f of x plus s is equal to f of x. That is, s is a period of f. and given an oracle access to wave, find wave. Then, in the classical setting, classical algorithms require exponential time to solve this problem. However, in the quantum setting, Simon's algorithm solves this problem in polynomial time. And here, I don't explain details of Simon's algorithm, but the important point is that Simon's algorithm solves this problem, this period finding problem in polynomial time. Next, I will explain about the key point of distinguishers, quantum distinguishers on Feistel. First, it is important to make a periodic function from the encryption oracle. In particular, it is very important to make a function capital F of the form like this. Here, B is a single bit input, X is an n-bit input. And here, Fi is the tilde round function. And please note that Fi is a tilde function, but for simplicity, I just write Fi. In addition, this beta b is a constant such that beta 0 is not equal to beta 1. And I will define beta 0 and beta 1 in such a way that these values depend on some secret values. Next, please consider this value. Then, with some calculations, we can show that this is equal to this one, f of bx. And this equation shows that this value is a period of f, and f is a periodic function. So, if beta 0 and beta 1 depend on secret values, we can extract some secret information by applying Simon's algorithm on f. So, this is the key point of distinguishers on Feistel. And the most important point is to make a function f of the form like this from the encryption oracle. Please remember this form because I will iteratively mention about this form. To attack the three-round Feistel structure, Kuwakado and Mori defined a function f like this. The right part of the encryption of alpha b and x plus alpha b. Here, alpha b is a constant that the adversary can arbitrarily choose such that alpha 0 is not equal to alpha 1. With some calculations, we can show that this function f is equal to f2 of beta b plus x. Here, beta b is f1 of alpha b. Since alpha b is a constant, beta b is also a constant. And since alpha 0 is not equal to alpha 1, beta 0 is not equal to beta 1. And since f1 is a tilde function, beta b depends on some secret information. And the most important point is that this form is the desired form that I mentioned before. And this function f becomes a periodic function, and the period is this one, 1 and beta 0 plus beta 1. And so, the three-round Feistel structure can be distinguished from an ideal random permutation by applying Simon's algorithm on f, because if the encryption oracle is the three-round Feistel structure, then f will be a periodic function and Simon's algorithm will return a period. On the other hand, if the encryption oracle is an ideally random permutation, then this function f will never be a periodic function. And so Simon's algorithm will not output any period. And so we can distinguish the three-round Feistel structure. This is how Kuwakado and Mori's distinguisher works. Next, I will explain about our polynomial time distinguisher on D branch 2D-1 round contracting Feistel. Suppose that the plaintext is like this. Here, x is a variable, and alpha b is a constant. And here, the important observation is the input to the round function is again alpha b, which is a constant, because this x and this x cancel out here. And so, the output of the round function again becomes a constant. And here, since f1 is a tilde function, this constant, beta b, contains some secret information. And after the first round of transformation, the internal state becomes x plus constant and constant x and x. In the second round, again, the input to the round function becomes constant because this x and this x cancel out. And so again, the output of the round function becomes a constant. And again, this constant depends on some secret value because f2 is a keyed function. And the internal state after the second round becomes like this. X plus constant, alpha v, constant, and x. And similarly, in the third round, the input of the round function becomes constant. And similarly, the output of f3 becomes constant. After the third round, the internal state becomes x plus constant, x plus constant, and alpha v. And the constants beta b, gamma b, delta b, these constants depend on some secret values. And in the fourth round, unfortunately, the input to F4 is no longer constant because this x and this x cancel out, but here this x cannot be canceled out. However, the output of F4 has the form like this, the round function of some constant which depends on some secret value plus x. This is exactly the desired form that I mentioned before, and we will exploit this structure later. And so now, after the fourth round transformation, the internal state becomes like this. The desired form plus constant and something and something and something. And in the fifth round, this value is just 3 to 2. This part. So after the fifth round transformation, the internal state becomes like this. Similarly, in the sixth round, this value here is 3 to 2 here. And in the seventh final round, the value here is 3 to 2 here, the rightmost branch. Based on this observation, we define a function f like this. The least significant n bit or the rightmost branch of the encryption of alpha b x x x plus alpha b. Here, alpha 0 and alpha 1 are constants such that alpha 0 is not equal to alpha 1. Then, this becomes f4 of eta b plus x. Here, eta b is a constant that depends on alpha b and some secret value. And since alpha 0 is not equal to alpha 1, eta 0 is not equal to eta 1 either. And so, as I explained before, since this is the desired form, this function becomes a periodic function, and the period is this one, 1 and eta 0 plus eta 1. So, as well as Kuwakawa and Mori's distinguisher, we can distinguish 4-branch, 7-round contracting Feistel with polynomial time quantum chosen plaintext attacks by applying Simon's algorithm on F. I explained the attack only for the case of 4 branches. However, the attack can easily be extended to general case. And we obtained this first result. Actually, today I don't have enough time to explain about our second attack. So please check our paper for details on our second attack. Next, I will explain about our related to the attacks on Feistel structures and contracting Feistel structures. First, I explain a previous work on quantum related to the attack by Rotterer and Steinwands. Suppose that the related to the oracle of an n-bit block cipher like this is available and queries can be made in superpositions. Here, the adversary can arbitrarily choose not only the plaintext x, but also the difference for the key delta. And the encryption oracle will return the encryption of plaintext X under the key K plus delta. And the adversary can choose both of X and delta in quantum superpositions. Then, for any constant M, this function fm, fm of delta is defined to be the encryption of M under the key K plus delta plus the encryption of M under the key delta. This function fm is a periodic function and the period is k. And so, by applying Simon's algorithm on this function, fm, the tk can be recovered easily. This means that in this scenario, arbitrary block cipher can be efficiently broken, and there does not exist any non-trivial dedicated attacks in this related key setting. Next, I explain about our related key setting. Suppose again that the related key oracle like this is available and the queries can be made in superpositions. But now, here, some specific bits, say the most significant W bits of delta, are fixed to be zero. Then, Rotara and Steinwand's attack doesn't work, because some of bits of delta are always fixed to be zero. And so, if the block cipher is really random, then it seems that exponential time is required to recover the key. And if a polynomial time dedicated attack breaks a real block cipher in this setting, then it would be a non-trivial quantum attack. So we consider related key attacks under this setting. As an example of our related key setting, we explain the related key attack setting on 5-round Feistel KF structure. And here, please recall that if the round function has this form, that is, the input is first added with the round key and then processed with a public function, then we call the Feistel structure as Feistel KF structure. And here, I assume that all the round keys are chosen independently and randomly. On this structure, 5-round Feistel KF structure, no polynomial time quantum single key attack is known. And in our paper, we tried to break this scheme under the quantum related key setting. And now, suppose that the adversary can arbitrarily choose plain text and the difference delta for the second round key K2. And the adversary can query plain text and difference delta in quantum superpositions. We call this scenario the related key model of pattern 0 delta 0 0 0 because the adversary can arbitrarily choose the difference delta for the second round key K2, but the difference for K1, K3, K4, K5 are fixed to be 0. We show that in this related key attack model, there exists polynomial time quantum related key distinguisher. And we also show other various related key attacks on usual balanced Feistel KF structure. But I don't have enough time here, so please check our paper for details. So far, I have explained that in our paper, we showed quantum chosen plaintext attacks on contracting Feistel KF structures and some related key quantum chosen plaintext attacks on balanced Feistel KF structures. And in our paper, we also showed that by combining these attacks, we can also mount some related key quantum chosen plaintext attacks on contracting Feistel KF structures. Recall that in the single key setting, our polynomial time attack on contracting Feistel structure breaks 2d-1 round. On the other hand, in the related key quantum setting, when arbitrary difference delta can be chosen for the dth key kd, then we can break 3d-1 round structure in polynomial time. And actually, we also showed some other related key attacks on contracting Feistel structure. Please check our paper for details. And so, I have briefly explained about our quantum related key attacks. And this slide again shows the summary of our results. We showed three results. quantum distinguisher on contracting Feistel and quantum key recovery attack on contracting Feistel KF structure, and some quantum related attacks on Feistel KF structure and contracting Feistel KF structure. That's all. Thank you for your attention.